So thanks for this kind introduction. In the next 48 minutes and 16 seconds, I'm going to entertain you about putting the grid under Cinegrid. So my affiliation is basically with the University of Amsterdam, but you may wonder what these other affiliations are. I run a group of about 40 people now, to be exact 42, which is the answer to everything in the Guide to the Galaxy, as you know. So if I hire somebody, I need to fire somebody now. These are actually funding organizations funding my group, and the fund size is proportional to the funding I get from those organizations. So without further too much delay, I want to remind you a little bit the Cinegrid mission. As Lauren yesterday told you, we started with this during one of the Optiputer meetings about 7 or 8 years ago, and we discussed a lot of this during our big hikes in the deserts here around and on the hills. And we came up with this Cinegrid mission, and I highlighted the words which are very important in this. It is a community, it is about research, development and demonstration. It is a networked collaboration for the use exchange of the media of photonic networks. And basically that is a large part what I'm going to talk with you about. Because if we look at the internet and we look at the different applications which are out there, we predominantly see that there are three different axes where the applications are developing themselves. So you have here the vertical axis, where you find very big data amounts, you know, the Google linked open data, weather information, or the CERN LHC experiments. And that are very big data objects which need to be either processed or moved to processing, or you move the processing to those data. Both things are nowadays possible. But you have another axis, and that's this axis. And that is where the social media are. Very small messages, but an enormous amount. And you have here an axis which is way more real time. This is the axis where you have the media, streaming, and gaming. So if you look what is important there, here you have speed and volume, but not necessarily a time constraint. Here you need to be deterministic and you need to be real time. If it is not real time or deterministic, you lose the game or your video just doesn't work. In this axis, you need to be very scalable for billions and billions of small messages. But what is often forgotten, you need also to be secure and you need to have integrity. So my group is actually doing research on all these axes. And we live, of course, here. And the whole problem is that people use the same infrastructure and the same internet for these three predominantly different kind of applications. So Lauren did yesterday not show his pyramid, so I do it. And here you see a little bit, but you guys should know by now. You have here the different resolutions and the different frame rates and so on. I'm not going through them, but you see that the amount of bandwidth you need if you want to transport this material uncompressed, that it really explodes, and this 25 gigabit for 8K times 60 is, if you do it mono and not stereo. I'm not talking about 3D. I learned my lesson during the dinner, and I liked actually your remark, do not compress when I am editing the material. So if you want to do distributed processing, and we are going to talk about that, do not compress during the workflow. Compress at the end when you start to deliver or map it to the devices where you want to project it to, but not in the process. But we are talking about quite some data, and of course after 8K, most probably 9K comes, or 16K, or whatever. If we look at the history, how computer infrastructure is developing, it is very a linear on an exponential scale, and that's actually quite amazing, because everybody knows, of course, the joke about the chessboard, and you put one grain on the first field and you double it for every next field, and then you run out of grain somewhere on the 20th field or something. So still amazing that computers are in many of these graphs still linear progressing. What you see here is the top 500 supercomputer list. So here you see the years, and here you see the most, the fastest computer in the top 500 list. And now they are around 10 or 15 petaflop. What you also see, this is number 500 on that list. And you see that number 500 lags behind about 7 years. This is the development of GPUs. And you see that one GPU is crossing the line, and maybe it has already because it is really accelerating, cross the line of the 7 year around now. That means that one modern card is as fast as 7 years ago supercomputer of about 20 million. You know, they always cost 20 million, they always use 20 megawatt. so you see that that line crosses. The funny thing is, if you would use your 20 million to buy for 10 million these cards and for 10 million stuff to put them in, then you jump to this point. But then you would of course argue, yeah, but to get data in and out of GPUs is kind of tedious. Yeah, but you have two magnitudes to go, two orders of 10 to go. So, okay, be 10% efficient. So you see what the direction is here. And basically you can also see it in these graphs. Every time you see here a jump, there is a kind of technology jump. So vector processors in grays, multi-core processors or threading, probably here threading and here multi-core processor. And now there's predominantly coming up a jump for GPUs in these machines. This is also very amazing. Data storage is also doubling for an enormous amount of time. The amount of data you can put on a single hard disk is unbelievable, but they are also on this kind of line. And the nice thing is, who remembers a floppy? This is a floppy drive. But if you go in modern Windows MS Word, you still find sometimes the icon for a floppy. Storage costs less and less. The amount of dollars to store data is really, you know, sinking to very small amounts. You can look that up yourself. That's also fairly amazing. And on the wireless, similar things are happening. So 1 gigabit wireless is tested in the labs. At home, I can already do 300 megabit from the laptop to ground stations, but effectively you use about half of it. So that's also growing, but not everybody is already used to it, as you can see here in this picture. This is, of course, getting accustomed to. And on the fiber, similar things are happening. So there are now coming devices on the market, or they are now for some years on the market, and they are more and more integrated in the infrastructure the NRANs buy from their respective vendors. Of course, multicolor DWDM, that's already out there for quite some time. To give you some idea, in the most popular band, they can put about 80 to 90 colors, which each have 50 gigahertz bandwidth, in one fiber. So 80 or 90 times 50 gigahertz channels. And in one such a channel of 50 gigahertz, they can nowadays, technology-wise, put about 200 gigabit in. So they now sell 100 gigabit. There's always some margin they use, of course, to be sure. But in the lab, they can get to about 200. If you want to do more than 200 gigabit in 50 gigahertz, it doesn't fit anymore. You need a wider spectrum. So what one fiber can do is around 8 to 16 terabit in this sense. There are also devices which can just flip colors. So you have devices like wavelength selector switches, and we have them in our labs, actually, to interconnect compute clusters, where you can pick colors out of a fiber and put them in another fiber at will. So you can say red from this fiber goes to that fiber, and so on. There are also devices which actually, in the photonic domain, can also change colors, but that is more tricky. But these things are actually already on the market. There are also some kind of magic numbers. And I show one slide later about why they can get at distances which are now useful for our field, like transcontinental or across an ocean without having electronics in between, only amplifiers. But this is also kind of an important number. So bandwidth times distance was a few years back 2 × 10⁻¹⁷ bits meters per second. So if you fill in the distance you want to go, you can calculate approximately what technology allows you in bandwidth without having to regenerate via electronics the signal. One of the tricks, and this is a sheet for dummies, how they get at these distances is that electronics has now become so fast that they can do signal processing on the signals. They feed in the lasers such that they can compensate for any distortion, or for most of the distortions, the fiber inflicts on the optics, on the optical signal. So one of the biggest problems in fiber is dispersion. And the physics of that is that the speed of light in material is actually dependent on the frequency. So different frequencies travel with very slightly different speeds. But at these frequencies and at the distances of 8,000 kilometers across an ocean, or 2,000 across a continent, or 3,000, that effect just ruins your signal. So if you want to send this, and you send it through a long fiber, then you have a transport function, you will end up with garbage. However, it is just like with old audio modems. You remember if you tried to phone into your university, you got all kinds of tones, and what it tried to find out is what is the distortion, and then adapt the signal such that you get a good signal at the end. So for dummies, you try to find out the transport function, make an inverse, you computationally multiply the inverse of that transport function with the Fourier transform of the bit pattern what you wanted to send. You inverse the result of this calculation, then you get a kind of garbage, and if you send that garbage through the fiber, then you will receive a clean signal because this distortion just annihilates the distortion you introduced. You've made a kind of counter distortion such that they both cancel out, and this is the formula which shows that, or this is actually the formula which shows that. So, and you can do that nowadays because you can measure the phase and the amplitude, and then you can do with a DSP at 100 gigabit the calculation quickly enough to calculate this and get the original bit pattern back and do the transport. And this kind of technology allows them now to go really through not too good fiber, but still go for 8,000 or 12,000 kilometers of fiber, which is Amsterdam, New York, for example. So this was yesterday's way of transporting material, scenic grid material. What you see here is actually 8 terabytes, and I say yesterday because Kunitaka asked Cosmin last week to bring scenic grid material in his suitcase. But this should have called me years ago. Nowadays, we should be able to use our fiber infrastructure to get rid of dragging around disks in your suitcase. And for that, we have this kind of infrastructure, the Glyph infrastructure. And so from the beginning, we started with Glyph, Global Lambda Integrated Facility, which is actually a consortium or a friends group of NRENs and universities like mine, to develop the optical photonic backbones in the world and to bring new ways of communication, just like I showed in the previous slide. How do you deal with different modes the internet is used? Can you put them on different ways on the infrastructure? And this is actually the playground. And actually, from almost the beginning, it became apparent that Scenigrid was a very good application needing extreme infrastructure to do its work. And so those two communities more or less naturally got together and worked together. So Scenigrid uses the infrastructure of the NRENs of Glyph to do all its magic tricks which you see here this week. So what you see here is a number of transatlantic fibers, transatlantic connections. So most of these connections are still at 10 gigabit. But we are already working with 40 and 100 gigabit on some of them. Here you see the 10 and 100 gigabit National Lambda Rail and Internet 2 infrastructure, and so you can recognize at least the network people amongst us can recognize a lot of their infrastructure. My group does one kind of research in this is that we look at these topologies and try to find out how do you deal with this multi-technology topology and how can you include that in the middleware such that applications can find and allocate end-to-end infrastructure slices which actually are compatible. I will say a few more words about that, but today not too much. But you can also see it as we apparently look for TomTom for these kind of networks. And remember, this infrastructure is not owned by one organization. It is actually a collection of resources from 20 or 40 different organizations. So there's also not a single point to contact. There's not a single source of information. What is all there? There's not a single ownership. So it is actually trying to pull together all the information and control it in a kind of distributed peer-to-peer like way. And we're already very far in that. This is a slide which I made about 10 years ago about why are we doing what we are doing? Why are we taking the approach in the architecture what we are doing? And back then we noted, and this was actually for iGrid 2002, we noted that we actually see three classes of users on the networks. Here you have the A class, basically comparable to those social media group. You do here your email or your short messages, but you have an enormous amount. Here's actually the number of users. I see that a little bit is cut away, but here's the number of users. And here is the typical speed what they need. So this is typically ADSL speed. You can live perfectly happy here with ADSL speed. B is more where you have data which stays within a confined environment. And CineGrid, so C is really the extreme applications from telescopes to correlators, LOFAR, or from CERN to the different organizations which process data for Large Hadron Collider. But CineGrid is a typical C-class application. The funny thing is, if you count all the applications you have in the C-class, you count all the applications you have in the B-class, and you count all the applications you have in the A-class, they basically have a similar amount of bandwidth need. So the total amount of bandwidth which is nowadays needed in the Netherlands for A-class is about 1.5 terabit. If you look at ServNet, what B and C are taking, they are also taking these kind of amounts of traffic. So when we looked at these things, we noted that if you have different kinds of equipment, there's also a factor of 10 in prices between them. This is a full backbone internet router. It can know everything about the internet. It knows where to send packets to, but they cost 75K per port. This is an Ethernet switch, costs about 1/10 or so. And this is such a wavelength selective switch, which just plays with colors. And that costs just 1 or 2K per port or so, per fiber, what you can put in and out. So you can put a lot of traffic through such a device, but of course you cannot give it much service. You can only say, oh, green needs to go there, but that's all. Here you can look in every packet header and determine what needs to be done and to which network it needs to go. However, for CineGrid, we know, oh, I want to go from the CineGrid exchange in Amsterdam to this projector here at Carl IT Square. So why do I need to route? I know already the route. So can I not go on a lower layer? This is a lower layer. And just keep the traffic there as long as possible. And yeah, you can see that in this text. And that is actually what we have been trying to build and to do in collaboration with EVL and Tom and his team and so on for the last 10 years. So this is how science goes. You are at the reception, you eat all these cookies, and then you make a plan, which we which actually we did at Terena in Brugge about 4 years ago. I was discussing with Lars Fischer, wouldn't it be nice if we had a computer at our university and somewhere else, and we just connect them on the photonic layer, nothing else. And this is actually what we did around. This was the photonic network of ServNet. This was the Nordinet network. Oh, we can go around this device here and then in Hamburg pass by from one photonic system to the other and then get end-to-end. We both signed it, and about half a year later or 1 year later, the whole project was done. And you see here the poster and the engineering. So we went on with that work, and about 2 years ago, we did experiments where we tried to send light as far as possible. So this was an experiment we did at TNC 2011 in Prague, in May in Prague, where from UVA we did send 40 gigabit to CERN. This is electrical, so we did send red, you see. So here it is electrical, we went back and we came back on another color. But this color was from CERN, sent to, again back to Amsterdam, to Hamburg, to Copenhagen, on a distance of 2700 kilometers alien light, crossing 6 different countries and 3 different optical systems of 2 different vendors. This was Alcatel and this was Siena. And it worked end to end. So the whole point is we try to get as far as possible on the photonic layer so that you have a completely deterministic network and possibly at low cost. So in the future, you don't not want to talk about getting, for example, VLANs or so on, but you want to get spectrum space on this field of photonic connectivity. Here you see that if you do scenic grid experiments, they are not simple. This is a network we did set up for 2011 on the scenic grid Amsterdam and scenic grid demonstrations. Here is a map of a 100 gigabit experiment we did from Denmark to Iceland. So this red part was completely 100 gigabit end-to-end from this point to this point, and the local loop was still a problem. So here we had 20 gigabit, and here we had basically more, but we ended up also with 20 gigabit to Amsterdam and also to CERN. So these are the kind of experiments, proof of concepts and experiments, demonstrations we are trying to build. Here's some rough results. So we did a number of experiments. You see that at some point we got, depending on what we used as software, we got up to 35 gigabit in both directions. This was actually a 40 gigabit experiment. The nice thing is you then get into all kinds of problems which you normally won't see in your computer. So this was a 48 core machine which had 4 chips with each 12 core. And it turned out that the core, the processor on which you put your communication makes quite a difference because the I/O is here. So if you are on this chip, you are closer to the I/O and you get a little bit more bandwidth. And you can see that here, this is per core, how much bandwidth got I out of the machine. And you see that there is a noticeable effect. So even if you are running your applications on this kind of infrastructure, you need to be careful about how you map it to your hardware. So this is actually Amsterdam. So this is, you see it is in a point where a lot of traffic is coming together. This is Netherlight, operated by ServNet, located at Zara for part and also in another housing. It is one of the most concentration points of scientific traffic in Europe. The other is of course CERN, there's a dark fiber in between here. And my office is just across the street from this dot, and that's very handy. I also have a lot of dark fiber directly into that dot. There are a lot of resources around Netherlight. The supercomputer center is there with the tier one for CERN, a supercomputer. We have grid and cloud stuff. We have visualization stuff run by Paul Wielinga and his team. So we have a lot to gather to really be an interesting endpoint for these kind of experiments. Things what are now coming up in our field are clouds, network virtualization. So we are working now on middleware and on an architecture and on systems and on software to be able to virtualize the network infrastructure. One of the main accomplishments of GLIF is now OGF NSI, Network Services Interface, which is basically a protocol to talk to the network and tell the network, oh, I want in this GLIF map to go from that point, make it so. So that is basically NSI, and there are a number of other middlewares and software which give you a control plane for the networking stuff. We are also working on the cloud stuff. You see that here, cloud APIs, Amazon, and so on. And we are also involved in a number of projects which virtualize in the same manner the computing and the storage, and then bind it all together. So what we need is infrastructure as a service, is network clouds, where your data can be distributed over this infrastructure and can be processed where it makes a lot of sense. One of the things, where we are really going to look into is the workflows, so that you can map different kinds of applications on heterogeneous sets of infrastructure and do that together with cloud providers in an elastic way. Because in my feeling, but I will come back later to that, the time that universities get their swimming pool size data centers, while out there the commercial world is building, you know, football field-wide data centers, or even much bigger square miles of data centers, I think at some point people will tell, well, you get your water from the utility, you get also your computer, your computing somewhere for a large part from there. So we need to be able to deal with elastic clouds from the commercial world, is at least my feeling. So we are looking at these kind of elastic application mapping, where you start the workflow, you do your compute intensive steps using dedicated and deterministic networking. You dynamically create high bandwidth networks. This is actually from Renzi, from a slide of what they are experimenting in Gini, and we are participating in that in some sense. You dynamically destroy high bandwidth networks, so you want to be able to control it, set it up, use it, and deallocate it, and you want to elastically add and release resources from the cloud as you need it. So what my group is doing is actually a kind of LinkedIn for infrastructure. So we describe different pieces in this whole field of infrastructure. We describe how they are linked together. And then we try to work with those graphs and do a lot of graph theory and allocation theory on such graphs. And I can assure you that is mathematically a very difficult problem. We are in an NP-complete problem, so nothing scales. So we really need to do heuristics and smart algorithms to make that work. But we at least have the information system is there. So using this kind of LinkedIn or resource description framework is the Web 2.0 term. We are able to describe networks. Network description language, NDL, is one such example. Scenic grid description language, CDL, is something we also developed and published. So you can describe your infrastructure, your cameras, your networks, the what type of networks and so on, and how they are linked and how they are related. But we nowadays are also working on that we describe content and information and how that is linked to infrastructure, so that you get location-aware content, or that you get information-aware networking, content-aware networking. So content-aware networking, if you look at it from this side, or network-aware content, if you look at it from that side. Because this is my vision, I've shown it before. So using IDF describing infrastructure, I do want a kind of I want infrastructure. So I want a movie with this content to be played on this tile display. So how do I get there? So you want to know, it is apparently on this platter, and this disk is connected to the network at this port, and then I need to go through there. But it is in the wrong format, so I first need to go to a codec, and then I come back, and then I can go to the display. So to do the TomTom, the pathfinding for finding this over multiple different types of resources, that are the things we are currently doing. And no normal internet routing protocol can deal with more than one type of technology. So what we are going the direction into is distributed computing, done that in the 90s. Grid computing was very hot in the 2000s, in 2000 till 2010. Since 2006, you didn't count if you didn't do something in cloud. Oh, if you are still doing cloud, passé. It is now big data, you know? I don't know. So at least, bear with me, we need to think about invariant things what we are working on. What is invariant across these hype terms? So what are the continuous problems we can work on? So what's next? The app, I guess. The application. So what I propose, and I did say that before, a kind of Lego block approach, an application as a service. We need elastic clouds. As I showed before, we need to get to determinism and real time. And we need a kind of scenic grid toolbox, so a kind of toolbox with different Lego blocks. Oh, I want to do this workflow, so I pull this together. And actually, one of the demonstrations this week is by also supported by one of my PhD students, Cosmin Dumitru, is building actually such a toolbox. So a short intermezzo. Yesterday, there was a talk about, you know, variable frame rate on cameras. You can remember that. So that we have that also in Amsterdam, variable rate music. I assure you, this is difficult. This is not easy. But I couldn't resist showing this. So, so now I have a few slides about how our research and how our vision in this is progressing. So why am I doing this research? You can ask, well, you are a faculty member, why are you doing this? Because I look at this, I want to show Big Bug Bunny in 4K on my tile display using green infrastructure. If I want to do that, then there are quite a number of things in this sentence. Yeah, it is this movie, not another one. It is in 4K, not in 3 or 5. It is on my tile display, not on somebody else's television. And apparently I have also the goal to do it in a green way and not in a brown way. I do not necessarily want to do it faster as possible, but in a sustainable way. But Big Bug Bunny can be on multiple services on the internet. The movie may need processing and recoding to get to 4K in the correct quality. It needs deterministic green infrastructure for the quality of experience. And normally the consumer or the scientist, if we are giving our advanced infrastructure to a biology professor or astronomer, they don't want to know that. Yeah, they have a refrigerator and that contains cool drinks, and they open the door and it just works. They don't want to know about technology of refrigerators. So, this is actually a slide from about 6 or 7 years ago. 10 problems with the internet. If you look at the internet, so in this article, he notes a number of problems. And I highlighted in red what we are working on, basically. You need energy efficient communication, explicit support for client server, control, management, and data plane separation, exactly what we needed in the first slide, about the different users of the internet. Isolation of different traffic, so that if one does something, it doesn't affect somebody else. Quality of service, real-time services. We do cross-layer communication. We do not necessarily completely keep everything separate. Support for streaming data and virtualization. So if I look at this timeline from 1980 till 2011, which shows you that the slide is 1 year old. TCP started to come into existence and different forms of TCP. We did ATM, another technical mistake, but that was a kind of underlying transport system to under the IP layer to do wide area transport, SONET, SDH, GMPLS, PBT, PLSB, OpenFlow, Next Generation Internet. So you see that every 3 years there's another term here that you need to adhere to, otherwise you don't count. So we worked in AAA, authorization, authentication, accounting. I was actually leading a research group in that in IRTF. Everything what is red, we ourselves participated in. Token-based networking, policy, different kinds of transport protocols, light passes in GLIF, hybrid networks, different forwarding technologies at the same time in the infrastructure to map your traffic. Network monitoring, virtualized cloud, network services interface, Cinegrid, semantic frameworks for Cinegrid, and so on. You see NDL here, network description language, green IT and networks, and so on. So where does this lead us? So I advanced the clock here a little bit. These are these lines. This is the good old trucking for traffic. These technologies together allow me to build a kind of virtualized internet, to make it into a kind of objects which you can allocate, deallocate, and so on. This is what you need for cognitive networks and clouds, technologies which allow the infrastructure to become smart, to become information rich. And we need this for sustainability. I mean, we are going to go into a sustainability cliff somewhere in the next few years. Energy price will only rise. So we need at least to have the information to be able to make sustainability choices. So my idea is if we combine this information and we monitor it and we use machine learning to learn from the past, from the current position and so on, then you can come to an infrastructure which allows you to do these I want kind of questions. And this is where I will retire. And okay. So if you currently look at our entire infrastructure, here we have tile displays, cloud, the networks, the storage, telescopes. 5 years ago or 6 years ago, there were not many standards to deal with infrastructure, to program it, to get information out of it. But now we have already a lot of standards, SAGE, CGLX, and so on. We have SAGA, GSDL, job description, job submission description language, OCCI to talk to cloud infrastructure, that is an OGF standard. User records, persona, net NSI. So you see there are now a lot of standards to talk to infrastructure. So, and that is below the service plane. So what I also want is that applications become able to tell how they are faring on infrastructure and that we get that information together. So everything you can monitor here, you put in some distributed databases. Everything what the application does and how they work on infrastructure you put in databases. You use machine learning, reasoning, scheduling, and that gives you a kind of way of to optimize things. So if you can combine these themes like sustainability, machine learning, graph theory, RDF, semantic descriptions, combine that with contextual information, logging, and historical information. How did it work yesterday? Ah, it was not so good. Okay, then I need to do something different today. Policies, you need a policy framework for your security and your integrity. You need an application feedback, monitoring. Put that in a blender and work on that. We did already do some baby steps on this, so we already made a programmable network model, which we then fed into Mathematica and gave Mathematica a kind of difficult problem to solve, a topology of where resources were to compute that problem, and an API to program that infrastructure, and then you put around it optimize and solve, and then magically Mathematica comes up with the optimal topology for the to compute the problem, and then also the solution. So if you think about this, and we have published that, that's already 6 years old. If you think about this, at this moment you make your network part of the programming model of your application. So everybody knows, or some of you may know, MPI, how you do parallel programming, that you have a do loop and you put parts of it in different cores in a CPU. You parallelize the execution of do loops. What you basically do here is you tell, listen, this is your communication you have, and you can use chunks of your communication with different parts of your algorithm. And here's a way to do that. So this is actually the MPI for networks. So your networks become part of the programming model of your application. Sustainability, I want also to make the point that we are really seeing warming of the Earth. If you don't believe it, here's the proof. So after having made that point, every morning when I step in my car, using a TomTom to go to work, although I know perfectly where I work, I can choose how I want to go to work. So I can say, I need to go to the science park. And then it shows me this. Do you want to take the fastest route, an eco route, or the shortest route, or do you want to walk today? Of course not, I'm in the car. But I can choose eco route. The whole point is that if I submit a computational job to the cyber infrastructure, I don't get such a screen. So I cannot say, like, oh, do me today an eco calculation. No, do me, I need it fast. Do me a fast calculation, a brown calculation, if you wish. I can't do that. So why not? So I ask my PhD students and so on, build me the information system, the monitoring system, and the control system behind such a screen, such that I can basically do that in a distributed way, in a multi-domain way, and so on. Of course, there are then a huge amount of problems, and that is where we live on in the academia. So, some final thing. About 2 years ago, we did an effort to collect from the community papers, because many of us, or some of us, are living in the academic world, and we have also to publish and not only to do fun things. So this we made a special issue of this rather high impact computer journal, Future Generation Computer Systems. Here you see the different titles of the different articles in it. It deals with everything with delay tolerant audio, as you saw yesterday also in the audio laboratory, tri-continental 4K and so on. If you wish to see one of these issues, I guess that Tom or you have them here in the office. If you want to download these are not freely available anymore to download. You have now to buy them, or you send me an email. I didn't say that. And that brings me basically to the questions and answers. So I thank you for your attention. Oh, actually, this slide is
on. You wanted to show your little video.
Well, if you want to.
I think so.
Okay, I just was notified that they got an extra few minutes. I have a video which shows a little bit what we are doing, but I had trouble with the sound, so I need to. Is this it? Yeah, this is it. I hope it works. So,
this is the future of the internet, yeah.
Sit back, relax, and enjoy.
A, the X10s are online.
Gentlemen, I am now about to send a signal from this laptop through our local ISP, racing down fiber optic cable at the speed of light to San Francisco. bouncing off a satellite in geosynchronous orbit to Lisbon, Portugal, where the data packets will be handed off to submerged transatlantic cables terminating in Halifax, Nova Scotia, and transferred across the continent via microwave relays back to our ISP and the X-10 receiver attached to this... lamp.
Look at me! Look at me! I've got goosebumps! Are we ready on the stereo? Go for stereo.
We turned our stereo down by sending a signal around the world via the internet.
Oh. You know, you can just get one of those universal remotes at Radio Shack. They're really cheap.
No, you don't get it. Howard, enable public access.
Public access enabled.
Boy, that's terrific. But I'll see ya.
No, hang on. See?
Someone in Sichuan Province, China, is using his computer to turn our lights on and off.
Well, that's handy. Here's a question. Why?
Because we can.
They found the remote control cars.
Well, wait, what's on top of that?
Wireless webcams. Wave hello.
The monster truck is out of Austin, Texas, and the Blue Viper is being operated from suburban Tel Aviv.
You may want to put on slacks.
What? Ew! Stop it! No! Leave me alone!
Who's running the red Corvette?
That would be me.
Okay. Okay.
There's something there about men and women as well. I'm not quite sure. In the internet. So, questions for Case.
Case, just a compliment. You looked really young on the film.
Next question.
I don't dare to ask which character you portray on me. Bazinga.
Jeff, I know you have a question inside you, just wanting to come out. No, it's too early in the morning. Everybody understands everything that Case said?
Okay, then...
There's going to be a quiz. There's going to be a quiz.
And the exams are after the break?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, well, really no questions. There you go.
What's the difference between cloud and big data?
In the cloud, they are way more centric about resources. So computer resources or having this or that application or something like that. So.
Your time's up.
Okay. So it is way more, but the big data is data centric. And in big data, for example, you are trying to collect data from many different sources and then process that in a distributed way. And that's where Hadoop comes in. That's a kind of divide and conquer kind of approach of finding data, process it, and bring the results back in a scalable way. So in the big data field, they are way more data-centric, looking where is the data and what kind of processing do I want, what results do I want to get out, and then bring that more and more central in different steps. While in the cloud, it is trying to make Lego blocks or virtualization of different kinds of resources and then offer them on a kind of market. So I showed you distributed computing, grid, cloud, big data, the app. The distributed computing was really a computer science era. They were looking at how can I divide this computing over different computers. The grid was meant originally to solve the problem for the high-end physics and the astronomers. How do you process these enormous petabytes of data they are producing? Then the market thought, this grid, we can use that also and sell that to on the market. Turned out to be a bit difficult. It also turned out that the market is way more interested actually in the data aspect than in the huge computation what the scientists need to process the data. So the market used mostly the data part of the grid. How do I publish data and how do I access data and how do I police and have policy on data and so on. The whole cloud came up as, we have now this virtualization, Xen, VMware, and so on. That now allows us to sell these VMs on the market. And that is now taking off to some extent. And so the next step is then, okay, the big data. Everybody's now looking for where is data and where can I extract value out of data. And then the next thing is the total integration such that you have these things which just give you the answer and you don't deal anymore with the notion of where is the data and the notion of where is my computing. It is just, I want the answer, make it so.
So Case, as somebody who is beginning to implement some of these concepts of network description language and centigrade description language, one of the challenges that I have and that as we try to proliferate this is I don't always know what I have. I don't always know what's on my network and what is exactly it's capable of and all of the details that might inform these automated processes. So are you seeing trends in manufacturing or do you have strategies for allowing people who own or manage these systems to be able to describe them in a way that is both accurate and dynamic at the same time?
So what we at this moment at least try is to come up with these frameworks, to come up with schemes and so on to describe resources, to monitor them. And the network community, the research and education network community has these technologies like network NM is network monitoring, has also made the implementations of Persona, for example, which allows people to look end-to-end connections, what is happening in all the in-between steps and so on. So to give in a distributed and in a multi-owner way, there are different owners of the different parts of the network, to provide that information. So what we try to do is at least come up with the architecture and with the message you need and with the schemes you need to make proof of concepts, to get them rolled out in the NREN world. So we are working with the Glyph community so that they implement that we can try out these things and we get quite some support for that. We are also working with the iGenie, with the Genie project in the US, and half of it is actually using this.
But what about the edge? What about the devices on the edge?
There it becomes interesting. What we do actually, traditionally, the networks are unaware of what's connected to it. And we try to make that jump by combining information of the resources with the networks. And we are very much in a research state, in a research and development stage. But I hope in the future that with proof of concepts within Cinegrid, Cinegrid is for us actually one of our demonstrators in this. We also try to do that in other fields. We are in a life sciences project in the Netherlands, in LifeWatch in the Netherlands, also doing this. We are in EU projects doing this. We have EU projects which also marry the cloud and the networks in this respect. The Novi project, for example, and also the Genie project for the cloud. And so it are baby steps, I agree. If it is commercially picked up, I do not know at this moment, but, well, I hope so. Or everybody should go to just one technology. Well, I don't believe that. Okay.
Thank you so much, Case.
Okay.